Arrangement of Great is Thy Faithfulness, which is one of my favorite hymns, and we'll be singing it later on too. And our second piece is by Cynthia Drominski, who passed away last year. Very prolific handbell music writer. And that piece has a lot of technique. Martellato, mark lifts, the hands on the bells. You know, it's very fun to watch. And then the piece during the service is one of our favorites, that Thou Art Worthy. And I play piano a lot. I just make up my own stuff, play with them. Nothing written, I just kind of go with the flow. Anyway, I hope you enjoy our music this morning.
Riverside United Church. What a crowd we've got today. You all came out for the bells, didn't you? You don't care about what I say. You just care about the beautiful bells, and I can't blame you for that. They sound better than I do anyways. So, welcome to service today, though. It's so great to see all of you here this morning. This morning, we're going to continue our focus on the Gospel of Matthew. We've been going through Matthew for the last week or two, but this is my first time leading worship with handbells playing. So it sounds and looks different this morning than other weeks, and so how exciting that is, and thank you, handbells, for the beautiful serenade you gave us earlier, and I know there's more to come, right? Right, more to come. So welcome to worship. We're going to sing a song together, so I'd invite you to please stand as you're able as we sing Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. To open again with some prayer, which will include the Lord's Prayer, so please join me as appropriate. Let's pray. God, we come to this time of worship, Lord, on this beautiful Sunday morning in mid-October, late October, God, just grateful for the opportunity, God, to worship you. Grateful, God, that you are here in this place, that you are here amongst us, God, that your Holy Spirit is guiding us and leading us in our worship today. And so, Lord, be in everything that we do, be in our songs, be in our prayers, be in our music and our bells and our voices and our thoughts and our hearts. Be present, God. And help us, Lord, this morning with whatever might be going on in life to also simply be present, to leave whatever might be ailing us at the door, to just recognize, God, the comfort and mercy and grace that you provide us no matter what might be going on in our lives. We thank you, God, for Jesus and for all that he's done, all that he taught us, and all that he continues to do. And many, one of the things Jesus taught us was how to pray, and so we prayed together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So for today, I want to ask a question in our service. Is it right? The main focus for this morning's message, as I said, we are continuing to follow the gospel according to Matthew. And this immediately follows what we're going to read, what we ended with last week. We talked about the grand wedding feast and how God's opened up the feast to everybody, not just a select few. It's an inclusive invitation as opposed to an exclusive one. And so Jesus shares this parable about a wedding feast, and then the Pharisees leave Jesus at that moment to go try and make a plan to trap Jesus, to trick him into saying something wrong, something that they can use against him. And so they come back to Jesus. So this is where our reading begins this morning when we get to it. They come back to Jesus with another group, asking Jesus a very different kind of question, hoping that his answer will trap him into one of those two groups, finding something they can use against him in that moment. Before we get into that question, though, we've got another song to sing. We've got the Young at Heart ministry. I think we have the handbells / choir anthem, one of those two. Handbells, yeah, I got the eye towards the handbells. So we've got a few more things to go before we get into the sermon and the scripture reading. So please join us in singing once again, Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God. Lori had asked to say something, an announcement, before I began, and then I didn't write it down, so I forgot. So, Lori, do you want to come up and share your announcement, please? And then we'll invite the children up as well for our Young at Heart ministry.
Good morning. As you know, the Christmas market, Christmas Bazaar is coming up, and that's what I wanted to talk about. It's kind of awkward in the middle of the service, but I can do my best. Just to let you know, we are still collecting donations for Christmas items that we can put on the tables to sell at the Christmas market. I made my list here. Where'd it go? Okay, so we are still have room for vendors. I can, I'm looking for about 10 more vendors. If anybody knows anyone who has a home business who might want to participate, that would be lovely. We also, if you could give them my email address, it's in the email that goes out for News for the Pews every week. We're also looking for shoppers, so it's about time to start stepping up on sharing the advertisements through Facebook and other social media items. Outlets, that is, pardon me. And then, of course, we get to the time where we need the volunteers to come and help. The event is on Saturday, November 18th. The Sunday before that is the day we'll be setting up the tables, and I'm hoping to get a couple men to come in, stay after church, and we just need to set up the 4-in-1 room with the longer tables. The rest the ladies can handle on our own. Then after that, that week we'll start emptying the boxes. As in the past, we'll come in the evenings and get everything set up and have some camaraderie and fellowship and some pre-shopping perhaps. And we have already started recruiting volunteers for the event day, but we still have plenty of slots to fill. So if you're available from 8 in the morning till 2 in the afternoon on that date, I'd love to hear from you. And on behalf of Trudy and myself, we'd just like to say thank you for all the support we get for these events year-round and on the day of, because that's what makes it all worthwhile, is all the fellowship and the friendships, and thank you. And you're rocking the hair, Diane.
So where's all of our Young at Heart and children this morning? Come on up. You want me to come get the baby? Pass him down the line. Passing him around like a football. All right, come on up to the front. Because I've got something I want to show you all and a question to ask as we come into worship in our special time this morning. Here, Jasper, you want to hold your baby brother? Don't drop him. Mom might get mad. Have you guys ever seen something like this before? What does this look like to all of you? It looks like a blanket, doesn't it? Does that look like a blanket to most of you? So, but it's a very special blanket, isn't it? Because it looks like it's personalized, doesn't it? There's some trucks and ambulances and buses on it. It's got somebody's name at the bottom. Can anybody read the name down there? Can you read the name? What is it? It's Jasper. So this is a quilt. Some people would call it is a blanket as well, but it's also special. It's a special quilt that my mom, his grandma Nana, made for him when he was younger, and so his name is on it. And I wanted to show you the quilt because a quilt is made of a lot of different pieces, isn't it? There's a lot of different stuff. Even on the back of it, you can see all these John Deere tractors and combines or something. I don't know what it's called anymore. It's got a big arm on it and it picks up dirt. And so quilts are made of lots of different pieces though, right? I can't hold Micah. No, not right this second. Okay, you hold Micah then. And so you see all these little patterns. You can see little squares and all this stitching in there. All of that is put together by somebody that puts a lot of work into making a quilt. And so all these little pieces are sewn together to make this quilt or blanket for somebody to use. And in life, and I think that's a good example of the story we're talking about today, where Jesus talks about rules and laws and what rules and laws we should follow and how we should follow the rules and laws. Shh. It's my daughter, by the way. I can tell her to shush. And so there's rules and laws that make up our society to make sure everything fits together properly and that everybody is safe and that everything runs smoothly. And I think a quilt shows a good example of what that looks like in our world today. So we're going to say a prayer, and then you can all head downstairs for your lesson. And Mike is just as loud as his sister today. And just as movie as well. Little struggle bus over here. We'll say a prayer and we'll thank God for our offering and everything as well as all of you. Let's pray. God, we thank you for quilts and blankets and for things that we love, for the offering that has been received this morning and the baskets at the back. God, we thank you for all of that as well. And we pray, Lord, that this church will use it to the benefit of not only ourselves, but the community at large, God, because everything that we have has been given to us, first of all, God, by you. So thank you for all the families and all the people present here today. Thank you for lessons learned and for the beauty of quilts and blankets and things that we hold near and dear. And we pray all this and so much more in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. All right, heading downstairs. You're what?
I want to say bye to Micah.
Well, no, Micah's going downstairs too.
Yeah, but he's
Is there a choir anthem today too? Yeah, perfect. We'll turn it over to the choir anthem. All right, that way, ladies. Thank you so much to the choir. I'll invite our reader up for our scripture reading. Our first one this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 45, verses 1 to 7.
You got a toaster down here. The reading is from Isaiah 45, 1 to 7. This is what the Lord says to Cyrus, his appointed king. I hold your right hand and will help you defeat nations and take away other kings' power. I will open doors for you so city gates will not stop you. I will go before you and make the mountains flat. I will break down the bronze gates of the cities and cut through their iron bars. I will give you wealth that is stored away and the hidden riches so you will know that I am the Lord, the God of Israel who calls you by name. I do these things for my servants, the people of Jacob, and for my chosen people, the Israelites. Cyrus, I call you by name and I give you a title of honor even though you don't know me. I am the Lord. There is no other God. I am the only God. I will make you strong even though you don't know me, so that everyone will know there is no other God. From the east to the west, they will know I alone am the Lord. I made the light in the darkness. I bring peace and I cause troubles. I, the Lord, do all these things.
So just a few moments ago, I talked with the children about rules in society and in our lives and how there's different rules and laws that we have to follow, right? You follow the rules and laws? A few of you are like, yeah, maybe sometimes. In Jesus' world, it was no different. There were rules and laws that they had to follow. And if you don't follow the rules and the laws of the land, you can sometimes get in trouble, can't you? When I was about 16 or 17, I had achieved the ability that every 16-year-old loves to be able to do. I got a driver's license. I took the test, the written test. I passed it somehow, and I was given a piece of plastic that told everybody else I was legally allowed to drive a car on roads that were around for people to drive on. Any of you done that before? Any of you drive a car, got a license? Maybe it was a couple of years ago for some. And so I could drive a car. But we all know when we're driving, there's rules and laws to follow, right? There are rules and laws to follow when driving because those laws and rules not only keep you safe, but they keep everybody else on the road safe as well. And not following the rules can have some negative consequences. Well, like many teenagers, I didn't have much room in my life for following the rules. I thought I could do pretty well anything that I wanted to do. Any of you have that experience in your life too? Yeah, a few of us, I'm sure. And so I thought that when I was driving my parents' 91 Plymouth Voyager, something like that, that's not an exact replica, but it's fairly close. May have been built here in Windsor, I'm not sure. But I was driving my parents' Plymouth Voyager, early 90s model, with a couple of my friends. And they came up with this great idea to take the van off of the paved roads and onto a less paved road. And because we were just driving around, it was me and my three best friends at the time. We were driving around, listening to music, killing time, because of course we lived in a small town. There wasn't anything else to do. If you're a small towner, you know what I mean. And so as we were driving, one of my friends suggested we should go trail riding. I'm like, well, what in the heck is trail riding? They told me, so we took the vehicle, the van, off of the main road. Not a vehicle meant for off-roading, right? Not at all meant for off-roading. And so the trails aren't as smooth or paved as other roads, and so it creates a very bumpy but fun ride. And I said, well, find me a trail and we'll go down it. Sure enough, he knew of one nearby. So he leads me to a trail. The problem is, it was meant for a snowmobile. So the van was about 6 feet wide, so about as wide as I am tall. The snowmobile trail was probably about 4 to 5 feet wide. So it was about a foot or two less narrow than what the van required. So we went down the trail, though, and went down from one road to another, and just a short ways away, maybe about a kilometer or so, we knew we were coming to the end of the trail, so we thought we were going to be smart. We got to turn off the lights on the van so nobody sees us coming. So we turn off the lights of the van, and we get out, and we actually approach the road to see if there's any other traffic along there. We didn't see anything. It was dark out. So we get back in the vehicle and we pull out of the trail and continue driving along. I think we made it about 100 feet when red and blue lights started flashing behind us. Now, at first we didn't think much of that because we were near the hospital. So we thought, oh, it's an ambulance. We'll pull over and let the ambulance go past the hospital. We found out pretty quickly it was not an ambulance. It was a police officer, and he was pulling behind us. He stopped with us. And so we waited. If you've ever been pulled over, you know the nervousness you feel in that moment, right? Just waiting what seems like hours for the police officer to finally get to your car window so you can hand him or her your like license and registration and all the things they ask. So the police officer comes up to the door and he looks in the car with his flashlight and he says, "Andrew, Mike, and Corey, I should have known it would be you three." Again, understand, we live in a small town, about 5,000 people. Everybody knows everybody else. And so I look at the officer and I said, "Hey, Blair, how are you?" Not only was he an officer of the law, but he used to babysit me and my brothers when we were younger. And so we have a bit more of a conversation. And he says, "Can I ask you guys, like, why I saw you pull out of that trail back there?" And I said, "Well, Blair," I thought I was smart, right? Teenager me. Every teenager thinks they're smart. We're not, but eventually we figure it out. I said, "Well, Blair, we were going the wrong direction, and so we backed up into the trail to turn around and drive and continue driving." And Blair looked at me and kind of smirked, I imagine, because he had seen us for quite some time. And he says, "So if I send my partner back there, we're not going to find any tracks or any trails, like it's not going to go very far." And I responded the only way a teenager knew how. "Well, Blair, we backed up pretty far." And so he gave me a ticket for trespassing. And my friends helped me pay that fine. And that was a consequence for my bad actions, right? I did not follow the rules, and I had to pay a fine because of it. And so we drove off back home with tree branches and mud caked on all over the vehicle. Eventually, I had to explain to my dad why the van was so dirty. And of course, he figured it out too. Again, small town, the cops knew him, and he knew them as well. And so this is a story about following the rules and laws of the land because they help us function as a society. Not everybody wants to follow the rules, right? Some people will say that rules are meant to be broken. Have you heard that saying before? But I think as we get older, and I've definitely understood this a lot more now that I have young children, rules are important for a functioning world. They help a family function, they help the grander society function, and when people don't follow the rules, it can cause discord, it can cause harm, it can cause all sorts of terrible things. And so we come to this scripture reading where the Pharisees and religious leaders are sick and tired of Jesus. So they say, "Well, we're trying to trick him in Jewish law, but he keeps not getting tricked. We can't figure out this. He's too good for us. He's too smart for us. He's not a teenager anymore. So let's ask him, let's send another group to ask him about laws of the government, laws of the land. Because the Jewish population don't always like the laws of the land because it can go against their Jewish laws and their ways of life." And again, this follows directly from where we left off last week with the wedding feast. And this is what it says, if we could get it on the screen, please. There it is. From Matthew chapter 22, verses 15 to 22, beginning at verse 15. "Then the Pharisees left that place," so where they were with the wedding feast conversation, "and made plans to trap Jesus in saying something wrong. They sent some of their own followers and some people from the group called Herodians. And they said, 'Teacher, we know that you are an honest man and that you teach the truth about God's way. You are not afraid of what other people think about you because you pay no attention to who they are. So tell us what you think. Is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not?' a laws of the land question to a religious leader in Jesus, a teacher. Notice how they begin, though. Teacher, we know you're an honest man and you tell the truth. Talk about buttering somebody up. You ever have somebody tell you how great you are and you know that something bad's about to come because of that? This seems to be what they're trying to do with Jesus. So the Pharisees, the teachers of the law, they're held in high regard by the Jewish population. Who might go to them for guidance, for wisdom? Pharisees didn't care about the laws of the land so much. They cared about the laws of God. The Herodians, though, right in the name, Herod, the ruler, the emperor, the Herodians loved the Roman law. They loved the Roman ruler and wanted to follow him like the same way that Pharisees wanted to follow the law of God. And they're not often bedmates. They don't usually get along, the Herodians and the Pharisees. But again, another popular saying, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. You've heard that before? So the Herodians and Pharisees are enemies, but they're also all enemies of Jesus. And so the Pharisees turn to the Herodians thinking, you're our enemy, but you're also the enemy of Jesus. So right now, you can be our friend. The enemy of my enemy is my friend. It rings true in this story. And so the Pharisees have asked Jesus questions about Jewish law, and he's always been able to answer them extremely well. So now they turn it around, try to trip him and trap him by asking him not a question about Jewish law, but a question about government law, the ruler, the laws of the land. Knowing that if Jesus answers based on Jewish law, he will upset the government rulers, the Herodians. So that they try and trap him into saying something wrong. They use a different group, the Herodians, to ask the question. Let's keep reading. Hear Jesus' response. But knowing that these leaders, at verse 18, were trying to trick him, Jesus said, you hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me a coin used for paying the tax. So the men showed him a coin. And then Jesus asked, whose image and name are on the coin? And the men answered, Caesar's. Then Jesus said to them, give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and give to God the things that are God's. And when the men heard this, what Jesus said, they were amazed and left him and went away. Answer seems so simple, right? But if we today took that literally, none of us would pay taxes. And who doesn't want to pay taxes? Because none of our money has our current leader's face on it. Some of you might say amen to that. Some of you might say, well, maybe he should have some. Jesus' answer, though, this deserves some more thought. Because sometimes things in our society might be okay, but things in our religious understanding are not okay. So something might not be illegal, but that doesn't make it okay for us to do as followers of Christ. A good example of that, I think, might be adultery. Adultery is not illegal, but it will not help you in your path to Jesus. It will not help you in your faith journey and life and how you grow in relationship with God. Because that goes against God's law, even if it doesn't go against society's laws. So just because we have to recognize sometimes that just because something isn't illegal does not therefore make it okay for us as Christians to do it. It can be legally speaking okay, but spiritually speaking not okay. And so Jesus' answer, give to Caesar what is his. Coins of the day have Caesar's image on them, something like that. A denarius, they are called. A day's wage is what that's worth. So for us, I mean, depending on where you work, anywhere from $50 to $200 a day. But for them, that was a day's wage, and you can see Caesar's name and image on the one side of the coin. So the coin is made in Caesar's image. It has his image on it. So that coin belongs to Caesar. So Jesus says, give to Caesar what is Caesar, but give to God what is God's. And what's made in the image and likeness of God? People. You and I. Every human that has ever been created has the image of God on them, just like that coin has the image of Caesar on it. And so Jesus makes the Herodians happy by saying, yes, pay taxes. That's okay, because that belongs to Caesar. But he also makes the Jewish population that love him and are following him happy, because he's also telling them, you belong to God. So you can still pay taxes and you can still obey God's law. Paying taxes does not go against God's law. Using these coins does not go against God's law. So give to the government what is the government's, but give to God what is God's. So is it right to pay taxes? In short, yes. Although I don't always like to say that or admit to it. Is it right to serve God? Yes. Can you do both at the same time? Yes. Is it right that I had to pay a fine for breaking the law as a teenager? Yes. Is it right that we're all here in this place to worship God? I would say yes. The people that are against Jesus try to trap him. Excuse me. The Pharisees and teachers of the law, they hoped to get Jesus to say something that went against Jewish law, but they couldn't. And so they get a government group to ask him a question about the government laws of the day. If Jesus simply says yes to paying taxes, though, he would alienate himself from all the Jews that have been following him and learning from him. If, though, Jesus says, no, don't pay taxes, then he can be charged for sedition and trying to cause a riot and a rebellion against the authority of the day. And so Jesus answers in a way that appeases both groups. Don't break any government laws, but don't break any Jewish laws either. You can do both from this question and from this answer. Jesus answers in a legally, ethically, and spiritually appropriate way. Something for us all to think about, I think, when we get asked similar questions in our lives about faith and life and how these things intersect with our society today. How can we answer questions, tough questions, about our faith in ways that are not only societally acceptable, but also spiritually acceptable? How can we as a church community and even as individuals reach out in peace, faith, and love to those around us to help them realize and understand that rules are not necessarily a bad thing? There's a reason for them and a purpose. Because we all know people who push against the rules the government sets up. And this seemed especially prevalent in 2020 and 2021. Anybody remember some of those groups? Just trying to push against the laws of the land because they wanted to follow the law of God, and yet many of us found ways to do both of those things. We weren't breaking any of God's laws by following the laws at that moment in time. How can we today serve and love God, but also serve and love our community, and even serve and love our government leaders, whether we like them or not? How can we today know what is right and what is wrong? How can we today look past our differences and look out not necessarily for our betterment, but for the betterment of those around us? Is it right? Is it fair? Is it just? I think we will figure that out, but it will take some trial, some tribulation, and a lot of conversation amongst ourselves to figure out those answers. But I do hope and pray that, like Jesus, when we're asked these tough questions, either of ourselves or of others, we can answer in not only ethically appropriate ways, not only societally appropriate ways, but also, I think, first and foremost, we answer in spiritually appropriate ways. Because we are of the Spirit, and so we represent the Holy Spirit wherever we go and in whatever we do. Let's pray. God, help us, Lord, this morning to realize that just because something is legally speaking okay, Lord, it does not therefore make it spiritually speaking okay. There are many things in life, God, that though are not illegal, they would not help our faith and relationship with you, God, grow. We know sometimes we're all asked tough questions, and sometimes maybe we're even the one asking those questions, God. Help us to learn from Jesus to answer in not only ways that are societally acceptable and ethically acceptable, but also, most importantly, God, spiritually acceptable. Help us, Lord, to follow the laws of the land, but also, God, to follow your laws for us. For every action has a consequence. Everything we do or say, God, can lead to good or bad consequences, not only for us, but also even sometimes for others around us. Send us your Holy Spirit, Lord, that we may not look out for our betterment alone, but instead focus on the betterment of others, that we will follow the laws of the land and also the laws of God. And therefore, God, lead others to see the great faith and love and mercy that you have and that we could have and should have in you. Help us lift up others, God, in our lives and in our ministry and in this church. Because as your word says, the first shall be last and the last shall be first. We lift up in prayer, God, all those who are sick and hurting, all those in hospitals and long-term care homes. And we pray especially for Christine, for Gail, for Linda, for John, for Jeff, and for Eleonora. And for all of us, God, who might be struggling with something or going through a difficult time, may you continue to be with us. May you guide us as you promised to through the darkest of valleys. And may we come out learning lessons and understanding that all of our actions do have consequences, God, good and bad consequences, depending on the action. So help us to follow your laws. Help us to follow the laws that the government has set up for us. And help us, most of all, God, to grow in relationship with you. And we pray all this and so much more in the name of Christ our Lord. And everybody said, amen. So we're going to sing a song, which I think, are the bells playing this with us? Great is thy faithfulness. Yes. Yes. So come on up, and we're going to sing together. Great is thy faithfulness. Did I end too quick? Thank you. for this morning. We do have an email list and a prayer list, so if you need to be added or know somebody that wants to be added to either one, please let us know. We have a faith talk, a Bible study every Tuesday morning at 10 a.m. downstairs, where we're discussing Paul/Saul and his going through his life and ministry to the church. Also, at 3 p.m. today, we have a special service here in this place, what's called a covenanting service, where I will make promises and you will make some promises, and what I think that's kind of the official beginning of our ministry here in this place. So if you're free at 3 p.m., that's today here in this sanctuary. We look forward to hopefully seeing all of you for that special time, and I believe there will be some refreshments after that as well, and probably some refreshments today after church, right? Coffee and tea, I'm getting thumbs up, so if you want to head downstairs and join us for a bit of fellowship, we would love to see you down there. Any announcements or news from the community? Anything that I forgot or missed? Hearing nothing? We should wave. Somebody just said we should wave. So we should turn around and look at our camera crew and wave to all the folks watching online and joining us from sometimes much further away. And so they can't drive here, because it would be a heck of a commute. It's been wonderful to be able to connect with all of you and worship with all of you, though, this morning. And I do hope you go from this time of worship, wherever you might be, knowing that we in the church love you, knowing that God loves you, and so go and serve others.